Okay, Kaylin, go ahead and crash the wall here and get into a new territory.
All right, so I'm going
Be
to talk about
controversial.
predominantly European lesbian vampire movies for
Ooh.
my side of things. I just started researching the genre a lot in general because when we decided we were going to do a vampire episode, I was just like, oh, I have the perfect subgenre to talk about. This is absolutely my jam. So I started to just kind of, be like, okay, how the hell am I going to narrow this to two films to talk about, maybe three? And basically, I just went for like the most overt, explicit, yes, this is gay stuff that I could find. So two of the films that I want to talk about are Blood and Roses, which is a French film. I cannot pronounce the title for the life of me. I do not speak French, but basically it translates
I
to
used to
die
be
with
able to
pleasure.
pronounce it. I'm good, pretty
Yeah,
good with French, but what I
I speak
forgot it.
Spanish, I speak Italian, I speak a tiny bit of German, I do not speak French. So out of luck on that one. But that one was made in 1960. And the other film that I want to talk about after that one is looking at my notes because I have the date on there and I don't have the date memorized.
I want
Sorry,
to say
Daughters of Darkness.
73.
What'd you say?
Is it 73?
Yeah,
The
Daughters of
next one in
Darkness
there?
is 73. I had to check. So yeah, Blood and Roses and Daughters of Darkness. So Blood and Roses is, in my opinion, of all of the lesbian vampire movies I've seen, the one that as a lesbian I watched and I was the most like, they nailed it. That's
Okay.
exactly what it's like to be like a queer person and like feel like you can't act on it. Like it is so beautiful. Although tragic, of course, we have to have the kill your gaze tropes because that's how everything works. God, we just can't have nice things. So quick, like very quick and dirty summary. I think most of you are probably familiar with this one.
Have not seen
I'm
it.
probably
You
the least
haven't seen
familiar. I
it.
mean, I'm
Now, Blood and
I
Roses, I
haven't
haven't
seen
seen.
it.
I've read
I have not
Carmilla,
seen
but
it.
I've never seen Blood and Roses. No.
I highly
Blood and
recommend it.
Roses
I
was
enjoyed
really
it a lot.
hyped in like Scott will know this, the Phil Hardy book. They really hyped that movie and it was hard to find. I couldn't find it for rent anywhere. I finally did see it on streaming, but
Well,
I
I
didn't.
do speak French, and it says "Et mourir de plaisir," or "Le sang et la rose." Le
Thank
sang
you, Scott.
la rose.
The Song of the
Yeah,
Rose.
I can speak
La
French, but
song, blood.
Yeah,
Yeah.
that
La
is the
song.
book. Yeah, that's
That's
a
right.
cognate with Spanish
La
words by
sang de
now.
la
So there you
rose,
go.
or Et mourir
Yeah.
de plaisir, which
It
is
reminds me
and the
of
pleasure
the
of
Jean Rollin movie.
and to die with pleasure, I think. And die of pleasure.
Yeah, like
Oh,
I can read
that
French
sounds
pretty
good.
well. I just don't know how to pronounce any of it. Yeah, I'm not that great at pronouncing it either. The
If you
talk
gotta
being an
die,
introvert,
you did
the
better than
talking part
I
was
would
always
have.
more difficult for me.
Oh my
I love
goodness.
French. I'm not
It's a
fluent,
beautiful
but
language.
yeah,
I just don't know any.
that one of those that title, and then the original title of Daughters of Darkness, which is very close. I'm trying to the Jean Rollin movie Lèvres de Sang, and Lèvres de Sang, Lips of Blood. You know, for that's how it was marketed for years, but its reputation as one of his best movies has risen. So I'm pretty sure now it's solely called Lèvres de Sang. So now everybody knows what it is, but. The Daughters of Darkness is similar, like Lips of Blood or something. Do you remember what it was? I can't remember what it translated as,
I gotta look
but
it up.
then they're like Daughters of Darkness or. But yes, Blood and Roses is definitely one I'm least familiar with, but I thought it was very interesting when I saw it. I just didn't have my full attention on it.
I'm all right. I'm trying to find the original title for Daughters of Darkness. Where is it? It is not easily coming up. I'm not
Saw
going to waste Les
y'all's
Lèvres
time, but Rouges. Yeah, I saw Daughters of
there he
Darkness. That's
said.
one of those that I checked out during the COVID lockdown that I'd never seen before.
Okay.
So that one's
Scott had it. Scott has the title. Say it,
Les
Scott.
Lèvres Rouges. Les Lèvres Rouges.
Lips
So
of
that's
blood or
red
blood.
lips.
Yeah.
Red lips.
It's
Lips
red.
of
Yeah, red
blood.
lips or blood red lips. I like Daughters of Darkness better, but.
Yeah.
Okay, so you
Red
want to talk
lips.
about.
It's a little less vague.
Red Lips is less obviously a horror film.
Yeah, that could mean any number of things.
Well,
Anyway,
go ahead and talk to us about Blood and Roses, because I'm curious what your take on it.
yes. Yes. So Blood and Roses is about a couple who are getting married and a young woman who is friends with them and the cousin of the young man. And so we've got Elsa Martinelli, love, playing Georgia Monteverdi, who is the young woman who's getting married to Leopoldo de Karnstein. Of course, that name is in all of the Empire movies ever. He's played by Mark Ferrer. And
Yep.
then Annette Storyberg as Carmilla. And Carmilla is also one of those names that is
Yes.
everywhere. So, fun fact real quick about lesbian vampire movies. They all basically stem from this amazing 19th century novella called Carmilla. So Carmilla is like the lesbian vampire name. It gets used everywhere. There are like a
It's the
billion.
text for lesbian vampires.
Yes, they're like a billion movies that have the name Carmilla or like some kind of anagram of it, which actually is also used in Blood and Roses, incidentally, because
Blood and blood's better, Brian.
and that one too. So Carmilla is supposedly in love with her cousin, male cousin, who is getting married to this beautiful young woman. The three of them end up hanging out together at the old Karnstein house. Golly gee, what's going to happen there? They're getting ready for the wedding. They're going to have the wedding there, basically. And then there's a party going on that they're having just to kind of celebrate the engagement and all that, getting ready to gear up towards the wedding. And then Carmilla, who is obsessed with an ancestor of hers whose name is Millarca, wink.
They're called,
and you know, she points out, like, oh, don't you think we look alike? You know, I have her face and everything. She has this beautiful white dress, which I still have because it's been in the family all this time. She then, during the party, goes and investigates Millarca's tomb, and you see her walk out, and she starts behaving kind of weird. And as the film progresses, you have Carmilla either possessed by Millarca or literally physically replaced by Millarca. It's not entirely clear. I interpret it kind of as a possession, because you still had Carmilla kind of like acting the way she normally would. There's no way Millarca could have known that, but hey, hand wavy magic stuff. I don't know. So that was kind of my interpretation on first watch.
That's cool.
So Carmilla is also very clearly attracted to Georgina. So she's, you know, supposedly in love with her cousin, and this is kind of like that, you know, bringing past to present. Like, Millarca was also in love with her cousin, so there's this parallel. And
You gotta
then
have incest in there somewhere.
you have to have incest in there somewhere.
It's always in the Gothic.
And you know, that's an interesting thing, like pairing like an incest relationship and a sapphic relationship. Like in a story like that, it's like they're both very very taboo like attractions. Granted, in Europe, cousins wouldn't have been that big a deal a couple hundred years ago when Millarca was around. But you know, in the 60s, it's going to be a little more sure about that. So as the film goes on, Carmilla starts acting weirder and weirder. Like she tries to ride her horse, and the horse is like absolutely terrified of her. She just starts behaving very strangely. She's exhausted all the time. She just like passes out, and doesn't really understand what's going on. You start to see her making more and more advances towards Georgina. And there's like this very tender kind of approach to the seduction there. That you don't see in a lot of other lesbian vampire movies, because in a lot of them, it's read as very predatory. I am sorry, my phone is not on silent like I thought it was. Go away.
You all good?
Outtakes. Yes. Sorry, that just really distracted me for a second.
Oh, no worries.
Oh my God,
We're
where
all
was
good.
I?
We're all good in the hood.
All good. All good, all good.
Anyway, you're
Well,
talking
she seemed
about
mostly
the
sympathetic to me, right?
seductive aspect of their relationship
Yes.
as versus the
Thank you.
predatory
Thank you.
aspect.
Yes, thank you. So there's like this tender kind of seduction where it's like you can tell the two women are kind of drawn to each other too. It's not all one-sided, and at least to me, it really didn't come across as like Georgina being under Carmilla or Marco's spell. It was really like they had this genuine love and bond and friendship that you see blossoming into more of a romantic love. And you see them just really, really drawn to each other. And in the end, you see that Carmilla has really explicitly fallen in love with Georgina. They do not leave you any questions about that. And another fun thing is that earlier in the film, while telling the story of Millarca, they talk about how her cousin, who she loved, she got angry because he cheated on her, and so she loved him, so he turned into a vampire after she died. Which is a really interesting way to go about it. Like, I don't think that there was like necessarily a bite. They had it be like connected to the emotions, which I thought was fascinating. And then at the end of the film with Blood and Roses, Carmilla ends up getting killed because there are explosions. They're trying to like do some crazy stuff with the grounds. I don't remember precisely what was going on with that, but an explosion basically causes her to fall and she dies. And then you find out later on it's suggested that Georgina, now that she has married Leopoldo, is actually the last female Karnstein, so she too is going to be a vampire. And so that was because Carmilla was in love with her. So it's this very explicit, very sweet romantic situation that I just found really, really interesting compared to some of the other films that I've seen with this going on.
That's cool. And Daughters of Darkness follows a very similar through line, except it gets into other realms, which what are very taboo, which is fascinating. But so whenever you want to, just go ahead. It's cool.
Of course. So then
I
Daughters
have
of
a question.
Darkness. Sorry?
Yeah, I have a question. Would you feel like it, would you say it's more romantic or horror?
Which
Like,
one?
what did it feel like? Which movie?
I'd
Like,
say
did it feel more like horror or romance?
I think I feel like there's definitely plenty of elements of both. I feel like I connected with the romantic side of the story more compared to watching Daughters of Darkness, for example, felt more very strongly horror.
Oh, okay.
So
Yeah.
they're both a little of both. But I think like Daughters of Darkness is more clearly horror because there's a lot more, gruesome, terrifying stuff going on, a lot more violence. Whereas Blood and Roses kind of feels like, Carmilla doesn't really know what's going on, but she has this thirst for blood, so of course she's going to, kill people and drink their blood as one does. But it doesn't really feel like they're lingering on that quite so much. There's like a wonderful creepy scene where she is just kind of like chasing somebody through the woods, and just kind of like running a little bit, but then walking slowly when the young woman like gets stuck in kind of the underbrush of the woods there, and she just kind of like keeps on walking, like that whole creepy like, I've got all the time in the world, honey, you're not getting away from me. Like, and there's some stuff like that. But it didn't feel like a scary film. There wasn't like any point in the film where I was just like, oh, this is giving me goosebumps.
Yeah, no, it
Because
has a
that's kind of
reputation as
that
being
was the other.
very romantic and gothic kind of.
So I think if
Very
I had
cool,
to
very
choose
cool.
one genre or the other, I'd classify it a little more romance than horror. But then to go into Daughters of Darkness, that one I think is definitely decidedly much more horror. And so Daughters of Darkness is, switch my other tab on here. So we've got Countess Elizabeth Báthory, who is the vampire in this film. She has been, traveling around Europe for however many years she's been around. I don't remember off the top of my head, but going to different places. So she goes to.
I think there's like at least 40 years between the time she sees the guy in the hotel, because he said he was a boy or a teenager, and now he's
I
like
was thinking like,
55 or
40, 50
60.
years. between I just meant like I don't remember how long she has been like a vampire and around, but
Oh, yeah, you're right.
yeah. So I don't remember that time frame, but you're right. It was about 40 years between. So she goes back to this hotel that she's gone to before, and there's this young, recently married and also recently met for the first time, presumably, couple that have gotten married and are, you know, kind of honeymooning, trying to go to England to go meet the guy's family. And actually, I've got a fun question about that whole family situation for you in a minute, because I'm still not sure how to interpret what I witnessed. Here's my
Oh, I can put a
yeah takes
spin
on
on
it.
it after seeing it a few times, but it might not be accurate though.
Fair.
So,
But
what? Yeah, the couple.
yes, so the couple is a young man and a young woman who met while the guy was traveling. She was from, I want to say it was Switzerland, and they just kind of decided to get married and just kind of like F off together, and it's
Have a
amazing
lot of
in
sex. Yeah.
all of the young, like, I just want to have sex with you and you're beautiful stupidity that young people do.
Right. Right.
I remember being that age. So that's all going on, and then the Countess and her aide, who is also a beautiful young woman named Alona, show up, see these couple, and are like, "Oh, they're so perfect. Look at them. They're both so beautiful." And you can tell, like, "Oh, this is going to be an interesting seduction type of situation. Like, are you talking about them being beautiful as in perfect specimens for getting your drink on, or are you talking beautiful as in I want to take them up to my room?"
Right. Or both, yeah.
So the Countess begins to seduce this couple as they're there. She's definitely going for both of them from the beginning. She's interested in both of them. So that also kind of touches on like the use of the terminology lesbian vampire, because arguably in some of these films, there's a very like woman on woman lean, and in other ones, there's a more bisexual lean. So lesbian vampire is kind of the term that's used to describe the subgenre in general, but some of the vampire characters I
Right.
would definitely argue are more bisexual. And this is one of them where it's like, okay, maybe actually she could be bi.
I tend to
That's
think of
fascinating.
vampires in general as just pansexual.
Fair.
I mean,
Yeah,
that's just
no, that's
generally how
reasonable.
I think of it,
Yeah.
male
Yeah,
or
like in
female.
Jessica. Yeah, like in
That's
Jessica, and I think wait, sorry, Jessica, there's what the Velvet Vampire. They're both the both, I mean, the two female vampires are bisexual, so yeah.
Yeah, Velvet Vampire structure is just the same as the movies you're talking about. It's just American. I mean, the structure is very similar, but they're good movies on their own right, especially the one you're talking about now. So on your own.
Yeah, this one's a good one.
Yeah, fair. So she's trying to seduce both of them. She starts, you know, kind of talking, trying to seduce. She's really talking to the guy, Stefan Moore, at first. And there's this like scene where he's like, "Oh, you know, I want to hear this story about like, you know, the Batory like bloodline and ancestors and stuff." And she starts talking about all of the horrible things that her ancestor, Elizabeth Batory did. And also, fun fact, that's a real world name. Which the person that I watched this with did not know that, and we got to
Oh
the
no,
end of the
what
movie and started
Elizabeth
discussing it. I was
Batory
just like,
lived, yeah.
yeah, Batory
Yeah.
was a real person who did
Well,
all
I
kinds of
say
horrible
I
fucked up
didn't know that.
things.
I did not
Yeah,
know that.
she's a real
Yeah,
person
and she
who's
really
like
did
bathed
bathe
in
in
the blood of
virgin's blood.
virgins. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't think
Yeah,
she did it as
actual
much as
historical
they
figure who
depict.
actually existed, and a lot of like vampire stories also kind of come from that bit
Oh
of
yeah.
history. Yeah.
I
A
had a professor who
fictionalized
was talking
versions of
about
her are
how he
very
did
common.
research on serial killers and he learned about her. And he also one of the things he learned is like it used to be that most serial killers were rich because they had the leisure time, whereas other people were trying to survive. So if they had those tendencies, they wouldn't be
Yeah.
able
But
to
then
do it because they were
vampires have
too
always been
busy trying to feed
aristocratic.
themselves.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
But then
this
vampires have always been aristocratic from the earliest ages too.
do
I mean,
you
there was
feel
powerful men.
do you
I mean, it's
feel,
kind of a
Jalen, that
metaphor for, you know, aristocrats preying on everyone.
absolutely it's what we were talking about earlier. Do you feel that that's the real? I feel it's the real Elizabeth Báthory. I believe she's exactly the same
Yeah.
person that's
I
historical,
think so too.
and she's still alive. I mean, I think that's what the movie's kind of driving at.
Yeah. Yeah, that's definitely how I
Báthory
interpreted it.
would have been one of the inspirations for the original Carmilla, which would have been an inspiration for
Yeah.
both of these movies. So this is kind of their callback to
Yeah.
Carmilla as well.
The
To
actual
kind of, yeah.
history and the callback to the novel and like the history
Yeah,
of
yeah.
like all of these
Okay,
sapphic
yeah,
vampires
that's
and women
cool. That's cool.
vampires. Yeah,
That's cool.
it's
That's a cool
awesome.
layer.
There's layers upon layers in this
Yeah,
one,
that's
and
a
I
that's new. That's a cool thing to know.
yeah.
Also, John Carlin's in it. Willie Loomis
Yeah.
from
Oh,
Dark
that's right. Yeah.
Shadows.
Okay.
So, and at this time, 1971, people would if they only knew him from Dark Shadows and see this, they would see a very different John Carlin. You see a very sexy John Carlin.
A very, to me, a very repulsive John Carlin once you get to know him.
Yes, but physically,
He's
very
really a
sexy John
troubled
Carlin.
person. Right? So go
But.
ahead, Kaylin. Sorry.
No problem. So yeah, fun fact, Elizabeth Báthory, real person. So she's seducing Stefan by telling basically the story of her ancestor, Elizabeth Báthory, but she actually probably is actually Elizabeth Báthory, who is also a vampire in this film, a literal vampire. And so the young woman is watching her new husband get seduced, and like as she's telling the story, he's getting more and more aroused. You and like the countess like starts like stroking his chest and all this. It's very, very sensual while she's describing dismembering people, bathing in their blood, all
Yeah.
of this really graphic, disgusting stuff. And
He's really turned on by carnage. They established that early in the movie when they witnessed an
yes.
accident. He's
Yeah,
really
yeah.
obsessed with that stuff.
Yeah, I was kind of like skipping some stuff to not have this get too long, but yeah,
No, you're
they
fine.
there's yeah, they basically like they go to one of the towns nearby. They see the victim of the vampires who's had her blood drained, like the little slip over her body as the paramedics are carrying her slips off, and he's just like, oh, this is really cool.
Yeah, he's kind of obsessed
And
with it, right?
obsessed. And Valerie is like horrified by it. She's just like, bro, what is your deal? You are being very weird right now. And they have this whole talk. And then, the seduction happens in front of her, where it's like, it's a mix of like, you're literally seducing my husband right in front of me. How dare you? And also,
It's turning
what
her
is wrong
on.
with you, man? She's suffering people and bathing in their blood. Like, who did I marry? Like, are you a serial killer? Am I gonna die? Because like I was watching
Yeah,
this and I was just like, is
exactly.
he a serial killer? Is he a vampire? Is he a Van Helsing? Like, what's gonna happen with this? Just kind of watching all of
It's
this
not
unfold.
good.
No, it's not. It's not good at all because he is in fact a terrible person.
Yes.
And yeah, he ends
Because he's
up
sexually conflicted.
yeah. He ends
I
up
mean,
being
that's
a
part of
domestic
it anyway.
abuser, basically. So he ends up beating Valerie and presumably raping her as well. You see them the next morning, under the sheets. They're both naked. Things happened off screen. I'm grateful that they faded to black.
It's an awkward moment.
Yes, very awkward moment. So then Valerie is like, she's kind of like trapped in this relationship, right? She's married to this guy. He's very controlling as well. He started to be very controlling of her and not really letting her have any agency. And then he physically assaults her like that and brutalizes her. She even has bruises you can see on her. And so she starts to try to run away. And she's like, all right, one and done, I'm out of here. Like, if he does this once, he's gonna do it again, right? Yeah, so she goes and tries to catch a train. The countess catches up with her, and basically, vampire seduction magic is just like, eh, da, 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 don't run away from me. And convinces Valerie to stay for a minute so that they can, talk and stuff. And so then the countess starts going hard after Valerie and sends Ilona to go seduce Stefan, which she does. So Ilona goes and seduces him. They have sex. He is taking a shower, and she is watching him, seeing the water like on his neck and everything. And she's just like, well, I'm getting a little thirsty here. And he basically invites her to join him in the shower. And she's just like, I don't really want to do that because of the whole running water
Yeah, running
thing
water
in
will
vampire
kill a vamp,
lore.
hurt a vamp.
Right. So, and then he physically pulls her into the shower with him, which is another assault. So I really hate this guy. He deserves what's
I
coming
do
to
think
him, I
he's more
promise.
playful with her, though.
He is a little more
I don't.
playful with her than he is with Valerie, but it's still
Yeah,
inappropriate.
but
He said, no,
it's
don't
that
pull her in the
aggressive.
shower.
It's that aggressive
Oh, I know.
masculinity thing, yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Yep,
So
absolutely.
he pulls her into the shower. She starts screaming as the water hits her because she's in pain. One thing leads to another. His straight razor blade that he uses to shave comes out of the shower, falls on the ground. She falls onto it.
Ooh.
Presumably, it's a silver razor.
It's silver.
Yeah,
Yep.
and so she's dead. She is super, super dead. And he's just kind of looking at her like horrified, like, what happened? Oh my God. And then, Valerie walks in and is just like, oh my God, what did you do? Again, part of the horror of
Course.
her reaction being, you cheated on me, you bastard, and part of it being, you just killed a woman in our hotel room. And so he then
But they
begs
handle
her
it pretty
for help.
well.
He's just like, help me deal with this. We need to fix this and make this go away. Oh my God. Then the
Oh,
Countess kind of steps in, takes charge, is just like, oh yeah, no, I've done this before, it's fine. Helps
yeah,
them get rid of the
absolutely, yeah.
body, clean everything up, and then they go dispose of the body. It's starting to get really late at night. It's gonna be daytime. She's like, oh, we really must get back before dawn. Ha 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 ha. All this stuff. There's a lot of just kind of like wink, wink, nudge, nudge. Y'all know the vampire lore, right? In this movie, which I really, really
Right.
love. It was hilarious.
Well,
So yeah.
I think Delphine Seyrig is having a go with the characters and with the audience.
Yes.
She's
Yeah.
just
Also, can
eating
we
the
talk about the
scenery.
cape
She's just
moment where she just like lifts up her cape and it's like bat wings? It made me laugh out loud. It was so cheesy. And I was just like, that does not fit with the rest of the tone of this movie, but I'm here for it.
No.
God,
Was she
it was
naked under it? Because
absolutely
that.
beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. I loved it.
There was
Ugh,
some
so. Oh,
nudity in this one, Scott. You'll like it.
yeah.
Oh yeah.
I was asking like when she puts the
Quite a
cape up,
bit.
is she naked? Because
I
that would be like
also.
super campy.
No,
I have
Andrea Rau
discovered
is
that I have a
naked.
gift for pausing movies at exactly the right moment if I want to like go get a drink or something. I managed to pause during that shower scene right before it got like creepy and bad, just like Ilona
Okay.
looking beautiful, and I was just like, awesome. I've had really insane luck with pausing movies lately. I don't know what it is. It's a pattern. It's hilarious. I also get really funny faces like between frames, and I'm just like,
Synchronicities.
amazing. Anyway, so after all of this, Countess's attention is really shifted towards seducing Valerie. And Valerie is kind of like drawn towards her, but also repulsed by her at the same time. So there's kind of this like playing with how much of her falling for the Countess is like vampiric seduction stuff going on, and how much of it is like repression in Valerie, and also repulsion by this guy that she's married that is absolutely insane. So it's very, very
She's not
complicated, and
just
I
being
feel very
seduced to
open
be
to
a vampire.
interpretation.
Yeah.
What'd you say?
I think she's not just being seduced to vampirism. She's not just being seduced to vampirism. She's being seduced to lesbianism because
Yes,
she has
it's
such a
both. Yeah.
toxically masculine husband.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, warning, fellas, we will steal your women. No, we won't. Not unless they actually like us. I'm being very tongue in cheek with all of this to be entirely clear.
It's all good. No, it's fine.
Very, very tongue in cheek. Yeah, so they get back, all of this is going on. Seduction basically ends up becoming complete. Valerie is like completely enthralled, whether it's by magic or, sexuality repression, like getting dealt with. She is acting kind of weird though, so I did interpret it as like a bit of like genuine attraction and also a bit of like sexy vampire lady. Yes, okay, I will follow you now, mistress, like type of deal.
Who can resist
And
Delphine Seyrig? I mean, her charisma is amazing.
yeah,
She's just an amazing.
I get it.
She's
I
not
get
just
it. No,
amazing in
I was
this
just
movie,
like,
but
the entire time. Yeah, no, I get it. She's
yeah,
wonderful.
like
Beautiful, beautiful performance.
seduce
Like,
me, Rat
wonderful.
Countess.
Yes.
This is really interesting because, like, the vampire films of, like, Jessica and Velvet Vampire, the woman where the woman victim is never really attracted to the vampire, but here it seems
Yes.
like they are.
Exactly. And that's why I picked these
Walking
two,
distinction.
because it's less predatory and it's more explicitly queer. So that's it's a little, I think, especially with Blood and Roses, it's very explicitly queer. And then with this one, with Daughters of Darkness, I feel like it's a little ambiguous, but I think there is definitely some genuine queerness there too.
The queerness really is in her husband, and that's an important thing, is that he keeps telling her it's his mother, and it's not. It's his homosexual
Yes.
got
It's
older
yeah,
man who
his
keeps him, his
yeah.
sugar
His
daddy.
yeah, his repressed
yeah.
homosexuality, yeah.
And that,
Yeah,
to me, the
I
way they
didn't
play it
like I
is,
didn't
you know,
entirely
real.
finish the like supposed to be quick but wasn't plot summary, but yes, no, can we please talk about Mother, because that was really interesting. So you interpret it
Oh,
as
sure.
like repressed homosexuality like on
Yeah, I see
Stefan's end,
that.
right?
I
Yeah,
see
I think
that.
that's
Yeah.
why he's so violent toward women,
Yeah.
and
Yeah.
also always trying to fuck women.
Overcompensation.
Yeah,
Yeah.
it's that self-loathing that manifests itself in violence and aggression, yeah, towards
Yeah.
women.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was more or less how I interpreted it as well. I was just kind of like, is this like, you know, one of those like queer like found family situations? Is this like your lover? Is this like, I don't know. Like it was very ambiguous, I felt, but like that character 1000% read as very intentionally queer.
Yeah.
And
Oh,
very like,
absolutely. He's
yeah,
kind of like an
very
old
very
school queen
flamboyant,
kind of
very
character. Yeah.
very femme, very like
I think
stereotypical
his
type.
wife, I think his wife is not necessarily, but is, you know, someone who just is pushed in that direction, but you know, not just, but that's also sometimes me projecting because I see sexuality as a spectrum. So it's like, I don't always see it as a bright line distinction, and people can be nudged one direction or the other. And I feel like, yeah, the events of this movie nudge her in that direction. That's where she starts finding solace and love. So that's where she goes, that kind of a thing. But I'm not necessarily thinking she's just a lesbian who found a lesbian, you know, versus, you know, Bathory, which I think she, like I said, I think she's pan. I think she's just willing. She's just sexual at this point.
Just
And
sexual.
and
Vampires
she,
are just
yeah.
complete.
I think
That's
Andrea
it.
Rau's character is pansexual.
Yeah.
Andrea Rau's, what's her name? Ilona. So
Ilona. Yeah.
Ilona, you know, but
Yeah.
this is what I wanted to point out. One thing is, he is more tender and playful with her, and I think it's because she's, even though it's obviously she's hot, but she's more boyish and slightly androgynous, and
Yeah.
I think that excites him, and she doesn't intimidate him, so he kind of is like, hey, I can just play with this chick and have fun, you know. And it's like the only time in the movie to me when he's really actually nice and considerate, at least for a couple of minutes, you know, like actually like touching somebody, and you know, like, I'm really attracted to this person. We're gonna have a pleasurable time together. Whereas the rest of the movie, he's just like a psycho when he gets into sex. So I think that twist, and it obviously traumatizes the fuck out of him, because he did not know, he did not mean to do any of that. And
Right.
then they kill him.
Right.
And then they kill him.
That was inevitable. But
Yeah,
that's a great
like
moment.
I
That's a
do
great moment.
understand that he did not mean to kill Ilona, but he was still an abusive shit. So I
Yeah.
clapped. Like I
Oh no,
was
I'm
just
not
like,
excusing him.
no, when they do that,
I'm just saying the
that's a
level of
great
writing.
moment, because the way, yeah, the way it's unfolded, we're cheering them on as they go in to drink his blood. You know?
Yeah.
Like the blood
Because it's like
happens,
he's
like
trying to be
Valerie has
redeemed at the end
evidently
in no
been
way.
turned. They're just like,
Yeah.
oh, the blood is like going everywhere. And you know, they both kind of clamp down on one wrist, suck him dry, dispose of the body,
Yeah, that
then
broken
go,
bowl, man, that's pretty brutal.
attempt to drive off into the sunrise. Oh no, the sunrise.
Yeah.
Yep. So they're talking like, you
The
know, whispering sweet nothings while they're
sunrise.
driving and everything. Elizabeth, Countess Báthory is like, my love, you need to drive faster. It's almost done. Let's go. And basically, they don't make it. The sun thing starts happening. She gets distracted. She crashes the car.
That's incredible.
Countess Báthory goes through the window and onto a wooden stake fence post.
In that way
The
that, in the
most
way that movies would do
ridiculous
back
death
then.
that I absolutely saw coming and just
Yeah.
cackled when it
Yeah.
happened, because I was just like, God, that was so
The way
predictable, but I
she's
loved it.
acting, I mean, she's such an
Well,
incredible
that was because
actress,
forever in those
Delphine.
movies, lesbian characters had to die.
Kill your,
Yeah, that
bury your
sucks.
gaze, bury your
Sure.
gaze.
Well,
Yeah,
not they
it's
didn't
a
always
thing.
die. They often, the victimized woman carries on, as she's going to tell us about it.
So, you know, unclear what has happened to Valerie at that moment. Báthory is obviously dead. Wooden stake directly through the entire torso. Very big wooden stake, very effective. And then
Great
we,
shot.
you know, we fast forward a little bit and we see Valerie talking to, guess what? Another beautiful young couple, a man and a woman who seem very in love with each other and very naive and very stupid. And she starts emulating Batory, speaking exactly the way she did, asking them the same
It is her
questions,
voice.
using the same tone of voice.
I don't think, I don't think, I don't, this is no, I read it because it's obviously dubbing Sarek's voice dubbed in. So I take, I'm open to interpretation, but I've always taken it as literal that she was so overpowered, and probably Batory has done this before to survive. Her consciousness is inside of her now. She
That's how
is
I
now.
interpreted it too. Yeah. I was like, okay, she transferred. It's literally her, and it's also Valerie's body. So
It's
there you
incredible.
go.
And metaphorically, we have, like, the cycle of abuse that repeats itself.
Starts over.
So this one's not as innocent and sweet and romantic as Blood and Roses. I did love it. I think it is very brilliant. I think it is
It's
very
a
nuanced
classic.
and very complex. So I like it for that reason. It's not my, like, oh my God, look at this beautiful lesbian res representation movie, but it is my, oh my God, look at this really interesting commentary on sex and sexuality and gender and abuse and seduction and all of that. Like, God of
I think it's just a beautifully shot movie. Harry Kumail is an incredible
It
filmmaker,
is.
and that's a Belgian film, and he has an international cast, and he's also known for Malpertuis, which is only just now starting to be known by people. But I can't I can't hold Daughters of Darkness in high in any higher esteem. It's like almost the top for that subgenre. For me, it's like the ultimate film,
I
but
would
that doesn't
it
mean
is for a lot of
it hits
people.
all marks.
I would say if it's one you haven't seen, you should at least see it once. If you're a movie
Absolutely.
buff, you should, especially a
Bill Hardy
vampire
told
movie
me
buff.
Sean. Bill Hardy's like, you got, Daughters of Darkness represents the psychological blah blah blah, the psychosexual, and nobody's seen these movies. Nobody can find them. You go to stores, try to rent them, and finally they come out on
But yeah,
DVD.
this is the one I watched basically back to back with Velvet Vampire like that. So that was my thing when I watched them.
I
Yeah,
wanted Velvet
so
Vampire on Blu-ray, but it went out of print. It's expensive. The Shout Factory one.
I caught it.
But one day.
I think I had I think I was subscribing to Criterion Channel right then, and so I was burning through some movies.
Oh, that's
That
cool.
was one of them, I think, that was on there.
I think I still have it. I think I still have a Sinister Cinema DVD of Velvet Vampire. I've had that for several years. So I've always had a copy. I had it on VHS, but it was just something me and my then girlfriend rented, and we, it was like kind of campy, and we liked Michael, what's his face from Beyond the Valley of the Dolls. I mean, he's incredible. Lance Rock, the strong body of Lance Rock, and then I thought he was so cool in that movie, and I just loved. I thought she was really stylish, and the music they're playing where they're in the dune buggy was really good music, and the music they're playing when he has the dream of her in the bed in the desert. And I was like, this is really a movie of its time. It's not like incredibly classic, nothing earth-shattering happens. It pretty much follows the exact plot of the movies we were talking about. But it's like, it is very American. It's very like Roger Corman-ish, and well, Roger Corman did produce it, so that's probably why. And it's a female director, Stephanie Rothman, who is one of his proteges, She did some good work. And so did you
Well,
want to talk about any of the titles?
this movie, I think what I just would point out one thing before Scott does it. You mentioned the how the ending happens. That's one of those things that I love about 70s horror cinema is the abruptness of the ending sometimes. I mean, I'm glad we got the little epilogue, but the way it just like goes and just boom,
And car
monster's dead.
crash.
Yeah, monster's dead, boom.
Incidentally, when I was in high school, I was subjected to unfortunately, my first ever Edith Wharton story that I ever read was Ethan Frome. And I was a closeted queer kid who was just reading this, like, why are you both so stupid? And I was reading it and I was just like, they kill themselves in the end because they can't be together and they're miserable. So they just like ride a sled into a tree. And I'm like, this is the stupidest thing I've ever read in my life. Here I am, age 31, talking about Daughters of Darkness and how much I love this ridiculous, like, queer relationship. And, bam, onto the wooden fence post. It just hits different, okay? I
It's
can't explain it.
synchronicity.
Yeah.